An F-15 fighter jet burns up to 4.5 litres of fuel every kilometre. And as they cover a kilometre in the blink of an eye, that's one gas-hungry bird. Worse still, to keep it light, the F-15 carries a maximum fuel load of 12,000 litres. So to make sure it stays in the air, it has to be refueled in the skies, which is one of the most dangerous aircraft operations there is. So, how do they do it? At Mildenhall Air Force Base in the UK, American pilots train every day, practicing this perilous flying maneuver, air-to-air refueling. To do this, you need some pretty special planes, and this is where the KC-135 Stratotanker comes in. You also need a crack team of specialized pilots, and they don't come more expert than these guys, the 100th Air Refueling Wing, which is dedicated to this single, highly dangerous task. Today, we're going to follow the 100th on one of its missions. The KC-135 is carrying close to twice its own weight in fuel. That's over 125,000 litres, enough to keep a normal car running for almost 50 years. But carrying that much fuel is itself highly dangerous. Much of it is stored in 6 huge fuel tanks spread through the main body of the plane. But a large quantity is also stored in the plane's wings. They carry fuel in the wings for one remarkable and worrying reason. If they didn't, the wings would snap off.
The design for the fuel to be in the wings is physics. What happens with wings is they fly up. And if all the fuel were in the middle of the airplane, and all the weight were in the middle of the airplane, your wings would actually fly up so high that they would separate from the airplane. And so with the fuel in the wings, it keeps the wings down as they create the lift.
The KC-135 is the workhorse of the Air Force. Sturdy and reliable, it's been in service for 50 years, and there are still more than 500 of them in use around the world. But air-to-air refueling is so dangerous, there's no room for error. So the safety checks are doubly important.
You really have to check to make sure everything looks good, because the wings are really heavy right now. Our jet's under a lot of stress with this much fuel. So, everything looks good today.
The checks complete, their mission begins. The F-15s which need to refuel are already over the Atlantic. They've just a few hours' fuel left, but the KC-135 is on its way. Before rendezvousing with the fighters, it has another mission. A Hercules transport plane also needs refueling. Using GPS, the crews arrange a time and space to meet up. But once they're within a few miles of each other, the system becomes less technical. They look for each other out of the window. The boom operator, John, is in a tiny compartment on the underside of the Stratotanker. From here, he can see the incoming plane, which is known as the receiver.
And right now, we're just waiting for the receivers to come up.
The boom operator has sighted the plane, and it now moves closer to the refueling aircraft.
After 20 years of doing this, I just hope that the receivers are very stable and we can get the gas offloaded real quick.
The receiver has to fly behind and below the KC-135. It's a risky operation, as the receiving plane could easily get caught up in violent turbulence from the massive Stratotanker. With both planes flying at over 300 kilometers per hour, the boom operator has to bring them to within just 12 meters of each other.
This is the fun part of the job.
As the Hercules comes closer, the boom operator uses signals to guide it into the right position. But there's still a huge problem, actually transferring the fuel from one plane to the other. On the underside of the KC-135 is an extendable boom. It's the key to air refueling. And the secret to guiding the boom into position are the two wings mounted either side of it, which can be remotely controlled by the boom operator.
I can fly the boom from
side to side, up and down. Wherever it go, wherever I turn my hand, the boom follows.
With the Hercules now in position, the boom operator first extends the boom by a further 3 meters. Then cautiously, a further meter. He's getting nearer the target, but it's only the size of a paperback book, and the two planes are both traveling faster than a Formula One racing car going flat out. This is the moment of truth. The boom operator must focus all his attention on making contact with the other aircraft. Bullseye. When the boom locks, it completes an electrical circuit between the two planes. Now the pilots take over. The stratotanker can transfer a staggering 4,000 litres every minute, but moving that much fuel that fast is a massive threat to the stability of the plane.
This is what we call a fuel panel, and in each number stands for the amount of fuel that's in that tank. So what we do is we look at the tanks and we say, okay, let's take a little out of this tank and give it to them, and we can actually stop the refueling and go to another tank while he's in contact. So it makes things a little easier. However, we have to watch the center of gravity while we're doing that to make sure that we don't give too much fuel from the rear of our plane, or our plane does this. If we give too much in the front, then our plane does this. So you're constantly monitoring everything.
These planes transfer fuel at a phenomenal rate. In 24 hours, an ordinary petrol pump still wouldn't transfer as much fuel as this plane does in just 8 minutes. Once they've refueled the Hercules, it's time to disconnect.
Offload complete. Disconnected.
And with its tank now full again, the Hercules is ready to continue on its journey. But for the KC-135, it's time to meet up with the F-15s. These fighters can't safely fly slower than 530 kilometers per hour, so the KC-135 has to accelerate to keep up with them. But once the F-15 has locked on, transferring 1,000 liters of fuel is done in a matter of seconds.